The following program was made possible thanks to the generous support of our Kickstarter backers.
Well, first Holmes was born, then he got fat, bald, and tired.
Sup, Holmes?
Beware! Your host, Jonathan Holmes!
Whoa, thanks, Sinistar. It's E3. Maybe they'll announce a new Sinistar game this week. Where you are, Brandon Sheffield, you're at E3-ish right now. Is that right?
I'm there. I am near to there. Yes, I will be at E3.
That's pretty exciting. You recently released a game called Oh Dear, which is also pretty exciting. The game people expected you to release, I don't think.
No, probably not. It's not quite released. It's releasing on Wednesday, they tell me, right in the middle of E3. I have no control over when it drops. That's all Sony Japan, but there's like nobody working on PlayStation Mobile anymore, so there's nobody to email to even confirm anything. They tell me that it's coming on Wednesday, but I don't know. I really hope it is. I hope it is.
It's been done for a little bit, is that right?
Well, we started working on it like 2 years ago, and it was... We left it alone. We basically ignored it for about a year of those 2 years. And then we found that PlayStation Mobile was closing forever. And so we were like, man, if we're going to do this thing, we got to do it now. So we just took I went to Poland and we took 2 weeks and we just banged it out and finished it up. It actually has only been done for 2.5 weeks.
I think you started sending it out right at that point. I think it was about 2.5 weeks ago that you emailed me about it.
Yeah, that's right. I wasn't sure it was going to get done at all, and I didn't know if we were going to be able to submit it, because we seriously submitted it hours before they closed the platform for submissions. I was at an event in Korea. And my internet wasn't working, so I had to, while I was in meetings with people, be like, uh-huh, and I'm typing information into the Sony backend to try to submit this thing. And I'm like, yeah, I'm totally listening to you, and I'm just submitting this game in the final hours, and that's how it got in there.
One of the things I love about you already, Brandon Sheffield, I think we met once before, a couple years mm-hmm. ago, just briefly, I think for Gunhouse, another game we'll talk about, is that instead of thinking, oh no, the platform's closing, forget it, you gotta think of something else, you're like, let's get it in there and make 2 months worth of money, it's worth it. Like you wanted to be a part of that part of history. You the larger picture, not so much just focused on the financial gains you'll get in the short term.
Yeah, well, we're not gonna get any financial gains from this. But it's long term, it's it's a strategy, really. I frankly feel that we will get more people playing this game because you can only get it for 1 month exactly than if it just came out 6 months ago and I was trying to promote it just on its own merits. But the fact that you've got a narrow time window in which you can get it, that's it puts some fire under you to go get this thing. And so that's I'm almost happy that we're doing it at the end, because it's more of an exciting story now. And I think that if we can get enough people to be interested in it, then we can get a publisher to pay for the final thing. Because to be clear, this thing that we're releasing we're calling it an alpha. And in fact, it even says in the title, Oh Dear Alpha, because It's not the full game. It's about 20%-ish of what the game will be. All the mechanics are there, the solid drifting, the look is there, the feeling is there, but we've only got 5 miles of track. Let me tell you how the game works now and where it's gonna go, basically. The game is, you've got 5 miles to go until grandma's house. You're trying to get to grandma's house in your family station wagon. But the road is flooded with deer because it's one of those, deer next 5 miles signs. And so, of course, for the next 5 miles, they're just scads of deer. That's what that means. So you're trying to hit or avoid as many deer with your station wagon as possible. And it accelerates like faster than a Ferrari and drifts better than a Hachiroku. It's really like playing Outrun 2 is kind of what we want people to get the feeling of, that kind of arcade style snappy drifting stuff. But what we have now is you can hit as many deer as possible or as few deer as possible and kind of try to challenge yourself with that. And there's also like a time limit that can kill you. But right now it's just the what we call the neutral path. But in the future, in the final version of this game that we want to make, the more deer you hit, the graphics will get dirty and gritty and bloody and terrible. And the more deer you avoid, the more the graphics will get like light and airy and rainbows and unicorns, but also kind of disturbing too, like deer with anime eyes and human smiles and this kind of stuff. So it's essentially like in the original Outrun, when you're choosing your branching paths, like you get to a checkpoint and then it's like you can go two directions. We're doing that, but with hitting or avoiding deer. And so when you hit deer, you will go on a different route. And when you avoid deer, you'll go on a different route. So ultimately, there will be 13 miles of tracks, and then there will be upgradable things for your station wagon. So eventually, you've got like 6 exhaust pipes and flags and all kinds of nonsense. But that's not in the game yet. Right now, it's just the solid drifting, the deer hitting, the deer avoiding. You can turn left, you can turn right, all the exciting stuff. The graphics, those aren't in for the dark and light. However, the music does get dark and light if you hit and avoid deer. So that pathing is actually working. So if you wind up taking the light path, you will hear lighter music. And if you wind up taking the dark path, you'll hear darker music. And if you wind up somewhere in between, and you hear the neutral music. So,
do you lose speed or gain speed or neither when you hit a deer?
Neither. deer are just like, it's like popcorn. They just explode in a shower of blood. It's like there's nothing there at all, except if you hit a speed up deer or a slow down deer. Those obviously speed you up and slow you down.
Gotcha. Yeah. Give me a little bit of a, did you ever play Tomena Sanner? A weird cell phone game that came to WiiWare later from Konami, of all people?
No, I did not.
You might like it. I'm not sure. You play a salaryman, a Japanese salaryman, presumably on his way to work, but along the way, he'll run into like breakdancers or grandmas, or then later, like dinosaurs.
Yes.
I think the last level is like in the Chinese hell.
He'll also
get speed ups and slowdowns, or not, or it just won't matter sometimes.
Is that similar to Incredible Crisis, I think? Yes.
I would say it is a very similar, like, in the same way that Paul Blart Mall Cop is similar to Ace Ventura. They're both, wacky character guy movies that are, you know, questionable whether you're going to like them or not. I don't like Paul Blart Mall Cop. I can't believe it. I think I set my expectations so low, I'm, like, almost into it. But anyway, Incredible Crisis, more minigame style. Tomato Sander is just kind of it's almost like if Cannonball had an ending and it had, like, dinosaurs and grandmas and stuff.
Yeah. And that, was that the same game or a different game from the one where with the PlayStation Move, you were like on an office chair and you were rolling down?
Oh, I forgot about that.
Yeah.
What was that called again? Like sliding or something?
Yeah, it was something weird that sounded almost sexual.
PlayStation Move, which brings me to so much to talk to you about. PlayStation Move, the thing I thought was going to be around like forever. I thought that'll just be the new thing that's always around. And it's not like technically gone, but the support for it has really dwindled. You've talked to Sony a lot. You probably know more than most of us do about their inner workings. And I don't want you to get in trouble with them, but I can't help but be curious. What do you think of the perception people have that Sony will put out a thing, a platform, a peripheral, whatever, and if it doesn't take off within like a year and a half, they like...
Yeah.
I mean, PlayStation Mobile been around a little bit longer than that, but it's still, it's kind of abrupt to see it just up and down.
Yes, it was. It's, you know, it's kind of a systemic problem within Japanese companies in general. Like Microsoft has different problems. They have a problem where they have too many people working on a project, and so it gets confused and scattered, and then it kind of dissipates that way because the messaging isn't strong and they don't have like concerted support for it. It's very scattered. Whereas Sony has a different problem where, you know, an initiative like PlayStation Mobile will probably originate in the US, but then have to be implemented by Japan. And then in Japan, they don't totally get why this is important. And why is it important to have like a, so like Xbox Live Indie Games was very similar to the PlayStation Mobile platform. Microsoft kind of let it go when they moved to Xbox One. And so then there was this opportunity for Sony to do something with that. And in fact, PlayStation Mobile is based on Monogame, which is what XBLIG was also based on. So it really is like the successor to Xbox Live Indie Games, PlayStation Mobile. But it was pretty resource starved right from the beginning. It didn't have enough people to work on it and to push it. And the worst thing about it was they had the PlayStation Mobile store in a separate tab in the Vita store. So like you've got three tabs: games, apps, PlayStation Mobile. And the PlayStation Mobile games are not in the games tab. So and you can't search PlayStation Mobile and that kind of stuff. I even wrote a guide for people to buy Gunhouse with, because I realized nobody even knew that PlayStation Mobile existed. And it was such a missed opportunity. And so I feel like most people don't really have that perception of Sony. They may just not even have been, like, I think people have forgotten about the move. Like, they probably just forgot that that existed. And PlayStation Mobile, they maybe never knew. So I don't think Sony loses much cred by doing it, but I wish they could support those initiatives a little more. And I know that the people that I worked with really wish that they could. And they helped me a lot. Like, because, you know, I'm trying to release this stupid deer game. And, you know, who do I have to talk to but these guys that haven't worked on PlayStation Mobile for like 8 months? And I'm like, hey, guys, I know this isn't your job, but can you please just help me get this thing out? Because, you know, it failed certification once because the Japan side, and we don't even know who's working on it over there anymore, but the Japan side viewed the hitting of deer as a realistic depiction of sadistic mutilation. Even though it's totally cartoonish and over the top and ridiculous, and, you know, games like Mortal Kombat exist.
Yeah, and, sure. I don't know what else is on PlayStation Mobile. I don't know if they have a particular refusal of violence or something, but I mean, ridiculous fishing is just on like every mobile platform ever.
Yeah, yeah.
Money, that sort of thing.
So I had to get the US guys to try to find anyone in Japan to answer emails to be like, can we just push this through? It's the last one. Let's just go. But so, you know, these guys have been very supportive to me, but I wish that institutionally it had been possible for them to support PlayStation Mobile a bit more.
Yeah, absolutely. And people say the same thing about the PlayStation Vita, which someone, I'm blanking on who, someone at PlayStation referred to as a legacy platform, I think a few months ago. I know there's tons of people at PlayStation, at Sony, who love the Vita, are constantly trying to get new content on the Vita, are talking about the Vita because it does have a lot of cool stuff on it. And then you'll hear somebody else within the institution look at it that way, and all those Vita fans, not that there's, you know, billions of them out there, but there's enough, and they're worried. Sony's gonna drop that as well.
Yeah, it's I really like the Vita a lot, and that's one of the reasons why I wanted to make this last thing for it. But, you know, there's another project that we're working on slowly, which is like a tactics RPG. And, you know, that's perfect for the Vita audience. And that's where I want to play that game. I want to play it on the Vita because I like playing RPGs on there. I like with these like much longer game experiences, I want to be able to pick it up and put it down as easily as possible. And the Vita really lets me do that, but on a nice, crisp, high-res screen and with a nice controller. I don't have to be touching on everything. I really like the Vita, and I hope it sticks around. I know that it's doing well enough in Japan and Europe compared to the U.S. In the U.S., it's not doing as well, but it's doing quite well in Japan and pretty well in Europe. So hopefully, fingers crossed, Vita is gonna stick around. Even if Sony calls it a legacy platform, as long as the audience is there, you know, I'll release my Tactics RPG on it.
Sure. Yeah. I think the worry was that Sony isn't going to put any more games on it. But I wonder, it's almost like what's going on with Nintendo in reverse. Like Nintendo, third parties aren't going to put stuff on it anymore. It seems like the Wii U. I can't think of a third-party Wii U game that's coming up anytime soon. But they seem to be doing better these days anyway, because people freaking love Smash Brothers and Splatoon. And so it's kind of like, doesn't matter. It'll just be our console. And the Vita is almost that in reverse. It's like it will be everybody but Sony.
Right, yeah. Nintendo is an interesting case because multiple times have asked me to bring our next game, Gunsport, to the Wii U. And I keep wondering, like, is it worthwhile? I'm curious if anybody's watching this right now, I'm very curious to know if you think that I should bring Gunsport to this platform. I have no idea. I don't know if the market is there. I don't know if it's worth, like, the 3 months it's going to take us to figure out their online infrastructure and make all that stuff work. We don't want to release it just like same screen multiplayer only, like offline only. Because Wii U would be the only offline platform then. I don't know. It's so hard to know where to put your games nowadays. I feel as a developer, like you can put it on everything. Like if you're making a game in Unity, it's sometimes it is as simple as pushing a button. If you have the right stuff set up, if you've built your game right, you can push a button and then you've got to build for this console. But that's not the end of it, because each has its own specific checks and things that you need. There are platform requirements for Xbox One and that are different from PlayStation 4, that are different from Wii U. And also the online infrastructure is different, and you've got to accommodate for all of it, and you've got to get the achievements in there and the trophies in there and whatnot. And so, like, while making a build for that platform, it can be very easy now, actually adapting it to be native to that platform is hard and takes a lot of time. And that's where it's like, I just don't know if it's worth it. So, you know, with the Vita, if I'm already doing PS4 for whatever game, then Vita makes a lot of sense because I'm doing a lot of the same stuff. But otherwise, it can be a hard sell, and that's where it's tough with Nintendo and Wii U, because nothing is the same as it.
Yeah. And nobody, like you're saying, nobody knows what's going to happen there. Games like Shovel Knight, that did well. Yeah. And then another game similar to Shovel Knight that just wasn't Shovel Knight exactly will like totally bomb, and then you know a multiplayer game will do really well, except for the next multiplayer game, which completely dies. So it is a scary prospect. For Gunsport, are you thinking that will be on Sony consoles, PS4, Vita, that sort of thing? Is that what you're hoping?
I don't know about Vita, but it's definitely 100% on Xbox One, PS4, and PC.
Oh, cool. Then maybe now's the perfect time to tell us about it, and then people can tell you later if they think it might survive on the Wii U as well.
Gunsport? So Gunsport is a cyberpunk volleyball with guns kind of a video game. It's 2v2 volleyball, but you're shooting the ball into the opposing team's goals or floor. And that's basically it in a nutshell. You've got two characters in the back called keepers, one on each side. They don't move, but they have a wider range that they can aim in, and they have two shots every time the ball crosses the net toward them, they reload. And then in the front, you've got strikers who can move and jump, but they only have one shot. And each member of each team has a different weapon, so there are a lot of interesting matchups that can happen. Like the Japan team is all about hitting the ball fewer times but harder. And then the Congo team, which is the other team that we've implemented right now, is about hitting the ball more times but weaker. Like you've got more hit opportunities, but you don't hit the ball as hard. And they balance out relatively well. We're still working on the balancing stuff. But and then each stage has its own kind of gimmick to it. There's one stage where the goals open and close. There's one where you're on a boat, and and so like you're on this boat, and the goals are on the sides. And when the striker jumps, the boat will shift, and so like the goals will move a little bit, kind of like a pinball tilt.
Yeah, yes, from the kickoff for the striker going into the
Exactly. And so or from landing. And so you like if you see the ball going into the wrong place and but you're jumping, then you can like try to angle your jump so that you make it tilt more, and then you can kind of like get the ball away from going into the goal or something like that.
Sounds awesome. off the top of my head, I'm thinking if Nintendo really wants it on the Wii U, you could say to them, can we have Splatoon hats in it? Because, mm-hmm. I don't know if you've played much Splatoon, there's an amiibo unlockable, actually. Maybe you should also demand amiibos.
Yes, that's what I should do.
There's more amiibos and Splatoon hats. There's a volleyball game in Splatoon, which like hundreds of people played now and liked. If they were to make that connection, you might be able to lob on to the... You know, I think Splatoon has sold like 400,000 units or something. So 1% of those people buy it for however much you're selling it, $10 or whatever. Then you've made 40,000.
Yeah. It's. I mean, that would be worth it for us. I mean, we live and work cheap. Like I'm the only person on the team in the United States. Everybody else is in, you know, Poland, Russia, Sweden, Hungary, Ireland, we all just live as cheap as humanly possible. So $40,000 for us is like a lot of money.
Huh?
Yeah.
That's Splatoon hats. Done deal. Get Damon on the phone.
I mean, if they can give me an amiibo, that's where the money is.
Yeah, no kidding, right?
Getting that amiibo money.
How did you end up forming this team? In Necrosoft Games, right?
Yeah, I got it.
No, that's right. I'm always nervous I'm going to screw up in the moment. I screw up a lot.
It's all cool. You didn't screw up, so there's no need to apologize.
So how did you form this team of people from Holland and Poland and all over the place?
Yeah, it's weird. We started out, Necrosoft started out as just me, and we made our first game, Gunhouse, with all local people in the Bay Area. I had Jim Crawford, the guy who made Frog Fractions. He was he's in Berkeley. I had Rich Vreeland, aka Disasterpiece, doing the music, also in Berkeley. And there was one guy in Texas, Juan Ramirez, the artist. And so we were all based in the U.S., but it was expensive and unsustainable, to be honest, to continue doing that. And I was on a trip to Poland when I was, you know, I was there to talk at a conference, and I just met a guy who he had made a lot of weird, crazy stuff. Like he made a game engine for the Game Boy Advance, oriented toward designers, so that you could make like a platformer or whatever for the GBA, and then it would output a ROM format so that you could actually burn it to a cart and play it on a real GBA. That was pretty crazy. And then he also made like this 3D shooter for the PS2. And he's like, yeah, but my optical drive broke. So I was like, I wonder if I can make this run from a memory card. So it runs from a PS2 memory card, which I didn't even know was possible. So I was like, hey, you're pretty good at this stuff. And he's like, yeah, you know, I'm just a game artist. And I'm like, but you did all this coding stuff. So you want to code my video game? And he's like, I don't know, I guess. So that's how I got the guy from Poland. And then... you know, his best friend from back from Portugal, because he's living in Poland, but he's Portuguese. He lives in Hungary. He's also Portuguese, but he lives in Hungary. I'm trying to collect all the Portuguese people in Eastern Europe if possible. If I can manage to do that. So he's working on our online stuff because, you know, he worked at Nokia and Microsoft and he wanted to quit his job and make indie stuff. So I was like, make our netcode. And he said, okay, the end. And all the, you know, pixel artists, I've been searching the world via Twitter and stuff, trying to find good artists. And I guess that's how it all came together, just like the internet and searching and trying, but also some in real life. I got one pixel artist from a different conference in Poland when I was there, and I was like, there are no pixel artists in Poland. It's really hard to find them. And then two guys raise their hand in the audience, and they're like, I'm a pixel artist. And so I was like, well, come work with me, please.
Wow.
And they did.
To be able to, these talented people who weren't necessarily aware that they had talent, you had faith in them and also told them that you noticed them in a way. It almost sounds like you're discovering some of these guys.
In a way, but also I also feel like they're deigning to work with me in a way, because like they're talented people, but they're all talented in different directions. Like the guy in Poland, his name's Desi, and he's always yelling at me because I'm like not directing things the way that he wants, or I'm not doing things like the perfect way, because he has this pure vision of how video games should be. And he has this like raw talent, but he's also very abrasive. And so, you know, we get these guys who are talented, but then Desi is art directing them and he's like, okay, I see what you were doing there, but it's shit. So do it again. and so we, you know, everybody's improving and we're getting fantastic art out of it, but also I think that it's not as like super altruistic and beneficial a relationship as you might have indicated there, because
what I meant to say more was that you are finding this talent but also providing them with things that, I mean, clearly without you, they weren't moving in the direction they are now. So
no, it's true, but yeah, I don't know. I just don't know if they're all happy.
Well, they will be, I'm guessing, once their stuff is out there in tons of people's hands. But this is the scariest, hardest part, isn't it? This is the part that instills the most fear when you've got this, like, we're on the cusp of making it, but we haven't quite gotten enough feedback from huge audiences to tell what's working and what's not. So it's like poking around in a dark room, I'd imagine.
Yeah, it's really hard to... It's hard to know if your game is going to sell. I have never sold a video game, really, because everything that we've made has had like some minor funding investment from Sony or Microsoft or a publisher, and thus far I've been able to survive without actually making any money off of selling a video game. We have just survived off of these bare bones budgets that we have, and partially it's our own like decision. You know, I released Gunhouse on Windows Phone for free. I could have charged for it, but I was like, well, Microsoft's paid us enough for it, so I'm just gonna let people have it, and then maybe more people will play it. I have no experience selling video games, and it really worries me and concerns me, because I don't know if anyone's ever gonna buy a video game that I make. Maybe they will. I just don't know.
It's gonna be terrifying. I'm sure that they will. They're really cool games, and they have something that everyone I know that's checked them out and played them, they get a feeling from it like right away. I think that's the trick. Like, if you're asking people to check it out for 10 seconds and they're not going to feel anything yet, then like, there's a million other things they're going to look at. But how long does it take to get a feeling from Odir?
I think in Odir it takes, I'm going through it in my mind. I think it's actually right at the like 7-8 second mark. Because you're going straight and you're turning a couple times, and then there's a big drift next to an ocean. Like, you got to make this huge drift. And then the deer approach. Like, you get out of the city, and you're starting to get into the country, and then the deer are there. And if you hit those deer, and they're exploding, and you're drifting, I feel like you get that feeling of what we're trying to do. So I think that we do try to give you some kind of a feeling as quickly as possible. I think we didn't do as good of a job with Gunhouse as we could have on that. But otherwise, I think we go for that feeling really fast because we're very very mechanics based, but also kind of we want you to have an experience. We want you to feel like you're in a world, like you're in a weird different place, and you exist in that world. And that's what we want people to feel, and hopefully they do. I don't know.
I hate to contradict you, but I got a feeling from Oh Deer instantly because it's called Oh Comma Deer at some well. Point. Like, yeah, or you, like you're it's like this faux worry that is immediately funny but also interesting. You're wondering, like, is this guy going to try to horrify me, or is he going to try to amuse me, or both? And yeah. Then in delivery, I think that you managed to do both very well.
Well, you know, hopefully. Now that I think about it, hopefully you'll get some feeling from the very initial screen, because when you start the game, you know, your station wagon is there, and like a 3-2-1 go thing kind of comes up. But while you're there, there's this big banner that says, get to Granny's. So you've got your objective right there. You got to get to your grandma's house. And at the end of the game, when you get to the house, there's like a creepy little silhouette of a grandma doing this.
do you know why you were inspired to come up with those particular ideas? Was it influenced from Outrun, which you mentioned earlier?
Oh yeah. I'd say the real thing, the way it came about initially was a friend of mine, who, like, back when I used AOL Instant Messenger, he sent me an IM and he's like, hey, you know those Deer Next 5 miles signs? I'm like, yeah. He's like, wouldn't it be weird if when you saw that, the road was just flooded with deer? I'm like, yeah, that would be weird. He's like, someone should make a video game about that. I was like, yeah, it could be called Oh Deer. And then that was it. And originally, it went through some weird permutations in terms of who was working on it. Originally, the very first team, and this was when I was still working on a magazine, was the coder was Mick West, who was the original lead programmer of Tony Hawk. And the artist was Super Brothers of Sword and Sorcery fame, because I really liked his deer. But then he kind of bowed out because he's like, you know what? I don't want to make a game about making deer explode. That's not really my MO to have something that violent. And then Mick West kind of went away because he had other things he wanted to do. So then I made it a new team with Junk Boy from Mojang doing the art. And we wound up using his mock-up art for quite a while. In our prototype, but then that fell apart too, and so now we've got like 7 artists working on this thing. But the real like coming together point was when I met Desi, the guy in Poland, and I was talking about this Oh Deer game and how that's what I would like him to work on, and how much I like Outrun 2, and he's like, yeah, well, that's one of my favorite games. And so basically, we both really liked Outrun 2, and that was a huge influence on the game, especially the drifting mechanics, and you know, heart attack mode in Outrun 2, where you're collecting hearts as you're drifting in order to please your girlfriend who's in the passenger seat. Like, that's very much kind of a similar idea to the Oh Deer thing, where you're drifting to get deer to get points kind of situation. So yes, Outrun was a huge influence. And so that's why it was super awesome to show the game to Yu Suzuki.
You showed the game to Yu Suzuki, the Outrun, yeah. Shenmue, Afterburner. When did that happen? How did that happen?
That happened at GDC, two GDCs ago. This was when we had a prototype of it. Man, that's a long time ago. Oh God, it's depressing. We worked on this game for so long, really off and on, but for so long. Hopefully you'll be able to tell when you play it. But yeah, I showed it to Yu Suzuki because he was there to do his Shenmue postmortem at GDC. So I you know, I met him at a party, and I had met him twice before, and we had had some conversations and stuff. And one of the super cool things about GDC is the few Japanese developers that get there, they don't have anybody to talk to because not that many people can speak Japanese. And so they've got like a super, they're like a captive audience for me, because they're like, oh, hey, here's a guy who speaks Japanese and I can speak to him, because I can speak Japanese, so I can like have conversations with these devs. And I've gotten so much closer to the game development community in Japan through them being in America, standing by themselves in a bar, like with a beer, just looking forlorn. And I'm like, oh, I'll just go talk to you because I can speak your language. So anyway.
Yeah, guys like Yu Suzuki, who like kind of built a fair amount of what video games are today.
Yeah, just standing there by himself because nobody can speak his language. And so that's, you know, that's how I got to scam my way into talking to Yu Suzuki, just because I could talk to him. So I was like, hey, I got this game that's kind of based on your archetype. Wait, is that the right word? Well, whatever.
I think so, yeah.
And he's like, oh yeah, I'd love to see it. And then I saw him later at another party, and he's like, hey, so where's that game? And I was like, oh my God, I really have to go get this game. I didn't have it with me. So I went back to my hotel, and I brought it, and he played it. And he looked really serious. I've got a picture of him doing it. He's looking at the Vita. He's staring at it. He's playing it. He's messing around with the control a little bit. And he plays it for a while. But like at that time, the tracks sucked. They're still not perfect, but they were pretty bad at the time. And the deer weren't really implemented correctly, and they didn't explode yet or anything. But the drifting was there, and the mechanics were there. And so he plays it, and he looks up at me, and he's like, it's not too bad. And I'm like, that's going on the box right there. Yu Suzuki, not too bad.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Wow. Do you think he'll play it again after it's done and he gets to see?
Yeah, I'm gonna send him a code. I'm gonna send him a code as soon as it's ready, and I'm gonna be like, hey dude, you gotta play this game. Give me a new quote and tell me maybe it's a little bit good or something, hopefully. I don't know.
And that would be the other way to sell it. If Shenmue 3 ends up being on the Wii U, it could just be in Shenmue 3.
Oh my God.
In the arcade or something.
That would be so cool. I'm going to send him an email about that. That would be amazing.
As you probably knew before I did, he's been tweeting out about, he's been showing forklifts and stuff, and everyone's freaking out right now.
Yeah.
You're at E3 right now. Have you heard anything? Have you heard Shenmue 3 is like a lock?
And then, no, I haven't heard anything one way or the other, but I do know that from my many conversations with him about Shenmue, he really wants to do it. He wants to do Shenmue 3. He's wanted to do it forever. Like, he cares so much about that series that he made this Shenmue game, which is called, like, it's called Shenmue Town or something. It was a mobile game for, like, feature phones, like flip phones kind of situation. And he cared so much about this thing that he actually still put in lines of code himself. He used like Visual Basic to actually wanted to be inherently involved with this project so much that like even though he had a team, he was like, no, I may be the CEO, but I'm gonna put my code in here. I'm gonna make my mark. So he really cares about this series. He really wants to make it happen. So, you know, if he's teasing stuff right now, I don't know. I wouldn't guarantee anything, but I would not be surprised if it was coming. He and I had a long discussion about Kickstarter at one point. And he was like, yeah, Kickstarter is possible, but I just don't know if the backing is there. And so like I put it on Twitter, and I was like, hey, Yu Suzuki wants to know if you guys will pledge. So like retweet if you would pledge to a Kickstarter for Shenmue 3, and it got like 500 retweets within like 24 hours. It was really, really quick. I was just gonna say like a related anecdote. You know, I talked to Koji Igarashi, Castlevania man.
Sure.
I guess it was last E3. I'm sorry, last GDC, and we were talking about Kickstarter. And he was like, yeah, could do Kickstarter, but I just don't think people will fund it. It makes me too nervous because like Japanese developers, they just don't have, that mindset. They don't know why they're popular in the U.S. Like they know that their games are popular in the U.S., but they don't understand exactly why. Like, you know, Iga with Castlevania. Castlevania was never very popular in Japan, like in its modern iterations. Like Symphony of the Night was popular, but all those DS games, you know, they sold like 10 times the amount in the U.S. versus Japan. I remember there was a stat of, I don't know which one it was. It was like, was it Portrait of Ruin or was it Dawn of Sorrow? I think it was Dawn of Sorrow. And it sold, Dawn of Sorrow sold like 150,000 in its first month in the U.S. And in Japan, in its first month, it sold 12,000.
Really?
Yeah.
It's a great game.
I know. And so it's, you know, it's, you get a developer who's like, yeah, I know that I'm popular outside of the country where I live and outside of the language that I understand, but I don't really get it. So, you know, he was worried about Kickstarter. He didn't think he was going to make it. Now it's the most Kickstarted game of all time.
Yeah, like six million, I think. We actually talked to him briefly for a print magazine. Destructoid's putting out a print magazine with Game Plan. Yeah, should come out like next week, maybe even tomorrow, the digital version. Yeah, hopefully it'll work out. And he played it much more cool in that interview. He was just like, well, yeah, you know, now that we've got a lot of money, that's nice, but there's a lot of pressure. He didn't show the amount of humility that he had. And it's very interesting. Do you think then that Yu Suzuki, as you know Yu Suzuki a little bit, mm-hmm. do you think he might look at Bloodstained and think, yeah, maybe I can do this too?
Yeah, you know, I feel like... like Mighty Number 9 is, it's not a great game, but it was a successful Kickstarter, and it was kind of, I think, the tip of the spear for the Japanese devs to be like, all right, yeah, we can do this now. We can actually do it, because there is that kind of, you got to do the right thing, you got to do the same thing as everybody else kind of culture in Japanese business, mm-hmm. especially in the games business. It's like, yeah, well, this is popular, so we'll do this kind of situation. You do wind up getting these people coming up with these crazy ideas to augment the popular thing. But there very much is like, we need to see a precedent before we can move on this. And I think that, you know, Mighty Number 9 and then Bloodstained, like, now that there are two positive examples of like, here's a creator who came back with their legacy thing that everybody wanted them to make in the U.S. and it worked. I think that, yeah, Yu Suzuki looking at that can have much more confidence if he were to do a Kickstarter.
Sure.
But he would rather get funding, is what he told me, like funding from a publisher, because it feels more secure. But I think now, maybe they'll do one of those like half publisher money, half Kickstarter things that is all the rage nowadays.
Sure. As long as the backers get the game and get some perks, they usually don't take offense to the fact that there's going to be more money coming in from somewhere, especially for something like Shenmue 3, which I presume would cost more than Mighty No. 9 or Bloodstained would.
Yeah.
If it's on the scope that Yu Suzuki would want it to be on.
Yeah, it's like, I think that's been the real stopping block for Yu Suzuki, is knowing how much that game cost before. Like, Bloodstained, yeah, you probably can make that for $3 million or whatever. But Shenmue, man, that game cost $80 million.
Forgot about that.
Yeah.
It was the most expensive game ever at the time.
Yeah, at the time. And you know, you're not gonna get $80 million on Kickstarter. You're not gonna. And Shenmue didn't make $80 million, that's for sure. So how is he going to complete his vision today? Like, the tools are cheaper, and depending on who he works with, you know, art labor can be cheaper than it was. But for the depth and the content that he wants, I don't know, it's going to cost a lot of money. He's probably going to need at least, like, if we're going to make a next-gen Shenmue, you've got to have, like, $30, $40 million.
Mm-hmm.
How's he going to get that if he's not bankrolled? So, you know, that's this is why I wouldn't guarantee that him tweeting about that forklift means that he's making the game, because
sure.
a lot of money is required. But maybe it's, you know, maybe it's episodic. Maybe he's going to kickstart episode one that's like an hour of content or something. You know, who knows?
I wonder, do you, because you're, it's fun that we're now talking about Yu Suzuki more than your own games. You still have it in you to be fascinated with this whole industry. It's great. And we haven't even gotten to the point yet that before developing games, if I know this right, you were also writing just as much as you were looking into development. Doing some journalism because you're interested in this whole world. I want to get your opinion as an expert. How do you think a Shenmue, I keep pronouncing it wrong, it just looked a little bit better than the Xbox version of Shenmue 2? If they were like, and we're going with legacy graphics, guys, so, you know, this is the world you loved, we're not gonna try to spend more money than we have on trying to keep up with Bloodborne and whatnot, so it's still gonna look the way you remember it, but we will get to make it now for $20 million or whatever.
So, you know, I would say that that's definitely possible, and I would be totally fine with it myself. Like, if you look at a game like Deadly Premonition or D4, these games are not the top of the graphical pile, but the content keeps people, you know, getting through it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, D4 got into the top 10 on Steam when it came out on Steam. It didn't do that well on Xbox One because Xbox One's market wasn't really there at the time. But on Steam, it got into the top 10 and it did well. And it doesn't need to look as good as Bloodborne. I feel like, I wrote about this once, I feel like we've reached a graphical tipping point to where, as long as you stylize your graphics, as long as it looks like it's in a style, and you know, with Shenmue, that would be, I feel like high-res, low-poly textures is a style. And if you've got kind of like your blue sky in games sort of like boxy dudes, they're still gonna look good enough. It's gonna look like you did it on purpose. Mm-hmm. And if you do that, I think people and it feels believable. It feels like a world. You know, it doesn't matter if it's not realistic looking, as long as it feels like a place you can go. You know, like Pixar movies, those aren't realistic.
Sure.
Of course, they've got amazing graphics technology going on in these things, but they don't look like human beings. They look like representations of human beings. And I feel like we've gotten to the point where you look at a Wii game, it doesn't look that bad. It looks like an older game, but it doesn't look that much worse, really, unless your graphics are like the graphics and realism is what you care about. You really want like those normal maps and those that specular highlighting and all that stuff. Like if that's what you want, then you're gonna be disappointed. But if you just want to play a video game, you're not gonna look at like No More Heroes on the Wii and be like, this game's graphics suck. They're so, you know, like low poly and there's no normals in here and like look at the lighting, it's all flat. It's like, who cares? At this point. And I feel like we're there now, where, you know, some people care were mad about the graphical quality of Deadly Premonition.
Mm.
But most people just didn't care. They're like, it looks fine, it's functional, and I get to be a part of this weird story, and that's what they really wanted. So like I feel like if you can make your graphics a base level of good enough, It doesn't matter, except for some really loud people on forums. That's about it.
And I guess it's because you can make people feel something, maybe even more intense, if you use a style that brings them back to a world and a time in their own lives. Like, I honestly, maybe people are going to think I'm being a hipster for this, and I do have a beard currently. So is that
and glasses.
Yeah, I know. So forget it. I'm in trouble already with those guys. But if I were to look at a Shenmue game that had Tom back, and mm-hmm. he looked the same, and it's Tom again. Like, just thinking about Tom, the hot dog salesman, yeah. I get, like, a feeling thinking
Getting misty, thinking about Tom.
Yeah, kind of him. And I'm picturing, like, Shenmue 3, Ryo goes off to New York City or something, and he's mm-hmm. like, Tom, I haven't seen you for a long time. That yeah. cuts over to Tom being like, I miss you, Ryo. I'd be like, oh, I'd feel, but if it looked different, if it looked like, you know, PS4 graphics, that wouldn't be Tom to me anymore. That would be right. like, this next-gen Tom actor is, like, kind of like Tom, but it's kind of not, like...
Yeah, like, so yeah. I feel like the closer you get to realism, the harder you have to work to make it actually real, and that's when everything just kind of falls apart. Because the closer you get to a real-looking human being, the more you notice that it's not a real human being.
Sure.
And when it's stylized, and when it's obviously not a human being, when it's cartoonish, when it's, you know, representational rather, I mean, it's iconic rather than you know, realistic.
Sure.
Then, you know, it's easier to relate to that because you've suspended your disbelief from the beginning. You're like, I'm playing a video game. This is fantasy. I'm not in a world that's real, but I'm in a world that wants me there. I feel like you're much better off making a game without realism if you want someone to feel something.
Yeah, I'm with you 100% on that. It's too bad I can't make video games. It'd work for you, but I'm terrible at those sorts of things.
You could do it. I believe in you.
Thanks, I appreciate it. How did you get started in the whole development side of things? Because before that, you were strictly writing about games.
So I started off writing for, like, really tiny websites, and then I made my own website called Insert Credit, which was pretty popular in the early 2000s. And frankly, at this point, I pretty much only work with people that read Insert Credit, because if you read Insert Credit, it means that you understand where I've been coming from for the last 15 years. And we don't have to have a whole lot of discussions about, like, what kind of games we like and what kind of games we want to make, because it's just we're all right there. We all agree. but then I was writing for Gama Sutra and Game Developer Magazine. I was editor-in-chief of Game Developer Magazine. And through that, that's how I wound up making a lot of industry connections, which is how I wound up being able to make a video game company, pretty much. But I started... I did some, like, really minor writing in games stuff, but then I did one thing where I rewrote all the text in the game, and it's a little embarrassing now, but it's called Barnyard Blast. It's for the Nintendo DS. It's about a pig in a cowboy hat. It's kind of like a metal, like a Contra-ish meets Castlevania thing. They kind of reversed how things should go, because your gun had infinite bullets, but your whip had, like, limited fires. Like, you could only use your whip a certain number of times. It was ridiculous. But, you know, they wanted a bunch of silly meme jokes, so there was all kinds of, like, it's dangerous to go alone, silly jokes in there. And the way that I wound up writing that is I met these guys at a thing called Game Connection that was associated with with GDC at the time. And it's just where there are a lot of kind of lower tier developers making, that have games that they're trying to pitch to publishers and stuff. And I was just walking around seeing what was there, and I saw some cool posters from these guys from Thailand. And I was like, hey, you guys got cool posters. What are these video games? And they talked about them. And I was like, well, I've got a film degree. You should let me write your video game. And so they did. Because I just bullied my way in with my film degree, and they're like, "Well, here's an American with a film degree. Guess we gotta let him write our game." After I had written one game, then the next time I wanted to pitch a developer on writing their game, I was like, "Look, I made this one. It's on store shelves. It exists. It's real. I mean, I didn't make it, but, like, I worked on this." And so from there, I just wound up working on a bunch more stuff. I did a little bit in Dementium, The Ward, just a little bit. And I did a fair bit more in Moon, which was a Renegade Kid made this survival horror on the moon game.
It's back on 3DS now, actually.
Oh, nice. I didn't know that. That's cool.
That's amazing. I had no idea. So, you know, Jules, watch him a bit.
Yeah, I know Jules. Jules and I have a tumultuous relationship. We don't see eye to eye on everything, but I think he's super great. We have a lot of discussions about it. The main point of contention is, like, is Nintendo doing good stuff for the industry or bad stuff? I'm on the bad stuff side. He's on the good stuff side, and we have troubles when we have conversations.
What a friggin' relief, though. I recently interviewed the developer, the CEO of the company that made Hatred.
Oh, yeah.
It was an interesting conversation. Really, like, light-hearted.
I can imagine.
Yeah, very, very, not what people would guess, I don't think. But yeah. But in thinking about Hatred, I was thinking about the fact that Hatred in part got well-known because of how politically charged the video game culture is now, game industry in total. People were, like, cheering for Hatred just because they knew it would make other people mad who they were mad at for making them feel guilty for liking. It was this whole psychological thing.
Yeah, it's really weird.
Republican-Democrat thing. The fact that you and Jules still fight about something as simple as Nintendo is like a breath of fresh air to me. I'm like, yes. Maybe we can go back to an innocent time.
Ultimately, we're all just nerds who like the stuff that we like. And he grew up liking Nintendo. And I grew up liking NEC and the TurboGrafx. I liked the PC Engine. That's what I liked. And that doesn't exist anymore. So, like, my battles are all lost. Like, all of my nerd battles have been decided. It's like, I lose. The end. So,
well, I mean, maybe this is me being pretty weird and nerdy. I mean, just maybe. As Sega and NEC in particular dropped off, I felt like Sony kind of picked that up. I think they kind of felt like they would be the new PC Engine. They saw that hole in the market because PC Engine was pretty popular in Japan.
Oh, yeah.
It was a big deal. TurboGrafx, also known as PC Engine.
For me, the successor to the PC Engine is the Saturn. Because the thing that I love the most about video games is when developers are trying something weird. And even if they fail, even if they don't get there, even if it's like 75% of the way to a good thing. If they can make me think, I see what you're trying to do here. If they can make me do that plus give me like a nice sunset and some rooftops to run on, then I'm cool. That's good for me. And the PC Engine had a lot of these games that were like, what can we do here? Because at the time, in Japan, it was one of the easier consoles to develop for, and it was the first CD-based console, so people were trying stuff with that, and they were doing experiments with music and weird, interesting stuff. There were all these RAM expansions to just try to get more out of the console. If you look at a PC Engine game from 1989, and then you look at one from 1997, it's just like, it's like you graduated from the 8-bit world to the 16-bit world, and it's almost like a PlayStation 2D RPG is what it looks like.
I didn't even realize there were PC Engine games in 1997.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, look up Legend of Xanadu 2. Look at the graphics in that game and realize that is on an 8-bit console from 1989 or 1988. And marvel at how far they pushed that friggin' thing. But then with the Saturn...
Xanadu 2, yeah.
Legend of Xanadu 2, yeah. With the Saturn, you know, they were moving into 3D. PlayStation 1 and Saturn were both moving into 3D, but Saturn was a better 2D machine. It wasn't really designed for 3D. It could do it, but it wasn't designed around that. It used quads, not your triangular polygons. Only NVIDIA's PC cards at the time and the Saturn and the 3DO used quads. And theoretically, it was better because it's like, it's a square. It takes two triangles to make this square. So you're saving space. You can do more. But in practice, like, if you want to make a sphere, With triangles, it's much more efficient, but with quads, now you got something real blocky. So when it came to realistic depictions of human characters, which I guess they didn't predict was going to be the thing they had to do, then it got a lot rougher for the Saturn. But people were experimenting with this kind of stuff because the Saturn had a different architecture than where the industry wound up going. So there were these 2D, 3D hybrids and all these just like weird experimental ideas, just like here's a developer with a little bit of money trying something. And so I feel like the Saturn was the natural legacy of the PC Engine. But then after that, it was the PS2 for sure. Mm-hmm. Like with your simple series games, that Success did, like the Giant Girl or Earth Defense Force, or you know, the ping pong friggin' game, or a Zombie versus Ambulance, like these, or is it it's Ambulance versus Zombie?
I don't even know which one is that.
It's a game made by a developer called Zicht et Un, and it's you're in an ambulance. And you're mowing down zombies as you're driving around. You're trying to get somewhere. And then you can just upgrade your ambulance with, like, spikes on the tires and chainsaws on the front and stuff like that so that you can destroy more zombies. One Chambara was also part of that simple series thing. There were just all these, like, weird things. Oh, I'm going to go on a weird tangent for a second.
Please do.
So One Chambara... Are you familiar with this game?
Oh, yeah. I always pronounce it wrong, and it makes people very upset.
Okay. Well, it's called One Chambara, and it's the lady in a bikini with a cowboy hat, like, chopping down zombies with a sword, and then her sword gets too bloody, and she's got to, like, slough it off, get rid of all the blood. That's the core mechanic of that game. So that is made by Tamsoft. Tamsoft is a company that almost went bankrupt. They had, like, a real roller coaster of a career. So they were the Tamsoft made Battle Arena Toshinden originally. Like, that was their first big thing. And, you know, Battle Arena Toshinden was very popular in the PlayStation era because it was the first 3D fighter that was not Sega. Mm-hmm. And it looked better than Virtua Fighter because it had more polygons and it looked nicer. So, you know, when you were comparing Virtua Fighter 2 to Battle Arena Toshinden at the time, Battle Arena Toshinden looked much better. Virtua Fighter 2 looks very stylized, and I like how it looks. But anyway, so they were doing well, and then they did Battle Arena Toshinden 2 and 3,
and then like an anime too, right?
There was anime. It was like a big deal, but then it started to. I think Pegasus was the last one. And then it really started to go downhill. I don't remember if they did one for PS2. I think maybe they didn't. They were just milking that franchise. They made like a puzzle game out of it. They were just getting whatever they could because it was their only thing, but you could see their budgets. You could see their budgets getting smaller, and you could see, I checked their, company listing at one point, and it was down to like 15, in the, early 2000s. Cause I was checking up on them cause I was curious, but then they got, into the simple series stuff, and D3 publisher gave them a bit of money, and they made One Chambara. And then One Chambara was kind of a hit, mostly because it had a lady with boobs and samurai sword and zombies and stuff, and it was like pretty easy money. So then they wound up making more One Chambara games, and their team started to grow again to where they were like making full-on Xbox 360 games. And, you know, there was One Chambara at TGS last year, like the new one. And it's crazy to me that company, like for a while, they were just doing nothing. Like they were getting whatever scraps they could pick up. And then they went back up with this One Chambara thing. But I think that's, they've ridden the wave, and that wave is crested. So now what are they going to do? I don't know. It's this company is very strange and interesting to me because they have had several, like, accidental feeling successes. Like, they got some big successes out of things that were not great.
Mm.
They had some big successes out of stuff that was like, good try. You were here at the right time.
Which is kind of one of the genres you're most interested in. Is this, yes. Like, we know what you were going for. Yeah. But you missed the mark, but you still made me feel something that I don't get anywhere else. Like, say what you will about Onee Chanbara, but it makes me feel something when
I hear it's different. It's definitely different. And like, one of the things I like about these guys, you know, I've been getting into them again recently. There's Battle Arena Toshinden, came out on the PlayStation. Saturn was not popular in the US, but it was very popular in Japan. So they made Battle Arena Toshinden S for the Saturn. And it was, Remix it was called. So, or maybe it was S in Japan. Anyway, whatever, doesn't matter. Battle Arena Toshinden Remix, it was definitely called in the US. And this was a remake of the original Battle Arena Toshinden for the Saturn. They redid it with quads and stuff, and it looked basically fine. But then they made Battle Arena Toshinden 2 for the PlayStation, but for the Saturn, they made this game called Battle Arena Toshinden URA. Ultimate something, I don't remember. Anyway, but that game, it's similar to Battle Arena Toshinden 2, but it is actually a direct sequel to the Saturn Remix game. So it's actually different. They're shared concepts, but at this point the game branched into two paths. And so you've got the Saturn game with like a totally different visual vibe because it built off the previous Saturn game. And then you've got the Sony game that it went in the polygons direction. Like the Saturn one has like all this neon and it's this crazy kind of Neo Tokyo vibe. And the PlayStation one is much more plain feeling to me. And it's really interesting that those two things diverged and they wound up making like a sequel to a port. And then making a separate sequel to the original. So they're like 2 and URA are not the same. It's not like a port of one or the other. It's not like they made one game and brought it to both systems. They made two separate games that were sequels to their own original, their own divergent path. And it's really strange and interesting.
I'm trying to think of another time that happened. The closest I can come to is how Strider had the NES port, which was really different. And then, but still, it didn't quite keep branching. And Bionic Commando as well.
Yeah, there was Strider 2 for the NES, right? So, wasn't
there?
Did I make that up?
I think you might have made that up. There was Strider. Yeah, I think this actually did happen. We're making sense now.
Okay.
We're smart video game guys. Nice. We know about the important stuff, like Strider branching path sequels. There was Strider on the Genesis, and there was Strider in the arcade. Then there was Strider 2 in the arcade, which took after the Strider model from Marvel vs. Capcom 2. But there was also this weird Strider 2 on the Genesis that I think was called like Journey into Darkness or something. Like
yeah,
that.
It was a U.S. gold.
Yeah, U.S. gold. What the heck happened to them? Maybe you should restart U.S. gold. I think that.
Yeah, I think they tried to restart somewhat recently, but I'm not sure if I'm right about that. I know that NEC Interchannel, which was the publishing arm of NEC, that tried to restart in like 2001, 2002. I was really excited because it was the legacy of the PC Engine. It was coming back. I think they only released two games. There was one racing game for the GameCube and then some other thing. But they just made a blip on the radar and then they were gone. They were just totally, totally gone.
Bummer. I'm still hungry for the Bonk's Adventure remake for the GameCube to somehow make it to this country.
Well,
I ended up importing it eventually.
Yeah. So that one is good. That one is actually really good. You can also get it on PS2, by the way.
Oh, I didn't know that. Good
enough. Yeah. The GameCube version I like a little better, but the PS1 PS1 version is definitely fine. But the GameCube one, because the GameCube had a better resolution-y things, it looks a little better. But they're virtually identical. And that Bonk's Adventure remake is really actually super good. You should definitely get it because they took the formula of Bonk and then they decided to add some things that seemed very natural, like natural extensions of that world. Like you can hit enemies when you're flipping in the air and you bonk them, and then they flip up into the air again, and then you can hit them again, and you can hit the enemies continually to gain vertical height. Vertical height, it's the only kind there is. that was really cool. And then they put a bunch of like secrets up there because, you know, I was thinking like, oh man, I just discovered that I could do this. That's amazing. It would be so cool if there was something up here to reward me for the fact that I worked really hard and I hit this enemy a bunch of times and I got up there. And there was a reward. There was like some stuff up there for me to get. And I love when there's that kind of like, you don't have to do this, but guess what? If you do it, it's there. And we actually, I haven't talked about this to anybody. We did that in Oh Dear.
Really?
Yeah, because there are some little spots where you can get out of the world. And I know that you can drive off the path and there'll just be nothing out there. You can get off in certain areas. And so I thought, if there are people that like this game enough and want to try to break it, I'm going to reward them and put little secrets out here. And they're just little tiny little things in certain places where you can get out of the world, where you'll just see some little assets that shouldn't be there. There's this one bit where I built this shrine of claws and deer skulls. It looks pretty cool. I hope that some people find it. It's in one of the stages, and if you get there, it's just this little thing that's there. It's just this thing I made out of arranging a bunch of art. And it's just a bonus for people that really want to pay attention. And there's another one that's it's like a perspective thing. Like you'll never see it if you're going fast and going the right speed and like drifting where you should be. But if you move over to the side a little bit, you'll see that there's like a cow standing on the castle walls, like a little guard. It's just a tiny little thing, but it's there.
That's awesome.
I put it there.
Yeah, you and if people will feel that way. They will feel like he put that there for me. Because he knows that I know what he knows, which is when you push the boundaries of these worlds that people made up for us, and you find that there's things there for you to discover, it makes it feel more real. Like if I decided not to go to work someday and like just nothing happened, like the world just disappeared, I'd feel like my world wasn't real anymore. But when you push the boundaries and decide to do what you're not supposed to do or you're told you're not supposed to do and more stuff happens, then you know that there's more to world than more to life than what's presented to you. So
I feel like if people push the boundaries, they should be rewarded for it because, I mean, that's all. If I get bored in a video game, or even if I like a game, but it's like, all right, I've done everything. What else can I do? And you should feel good because you pushed against a thing. And it like if it breaks, that's fine. But you should get something out of it.
Yeah, something should happen. Absolutely, I couldn't agree more. How would you? The interesting thing, one of the interesting things about what you're doing is it's charged by like a love of game mechanics. And a fascination with things that, frankly, like you don't seem like you can help but be fascinated with Ballerina Toshinden.
Oh yeah,
and that you it's not like you're choosing to be this guy who is been for a long time ever since you were young.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, so you're charged with like a love of mechanics, a fascination with the stranger side of games, I think. And combining it with a style that, even though a lot of the games you grew up loving were Japanese, it still seems pretty uniquely American to me, anyway, or at least American European. How do you think all that's kind of coming together to express Necrosoft? What do you think people are getting from that?
Sorry, repeat that last part again. I started reading questions.
Oh, no problem. Yeah, I know. They're very distracting. Well, I'll elaborate the question a little bit. Like, if I were to, people would ask me, like, well, what kind of games does Necrosoft make? I'd be like, well, not like Hotline Miami, because Hotline Miami, like, makes you feel like you got red blood slime dumped on you. Like it makes you feel a little bit like you're in a Cronenberg nightmare, but it's also like funny and cool in a way. But I'd probably place you in the Bow Blythe, Samurai Gun, Glambeer, world. And that makes me wonder if Devolver has been trying to get you to do stuff with them because.
I'm trying. I'm really trying to get Devolver to publish the final version of Odir. I really can't imagine another publisher doing a better job with it than them. I feel like it's the natural fit, and I'm going to meet with them at E3. Fingers crossed, everybody.
Oh, cool. Tell if you see Nigel, tell him I said hello.
I'm going to see him. I'm going to see him. I'm going to put Odir in his hands and be like, give me money. I'm going to see him.
Makes perfect sense to me.
If we're talking about like the style of Necrosoft, it's like, I would say we're continuing to try different things. My personal feeling is I want to try stuff. I want to see what we can do. And then the people I work with, like that guy Desi in Poland, he's so good at telling me when my idea is stupid, but also taking my idea and making it really work. Like, you know, on Odir, most of what I did was concept stuff and trying to get people to finish assets and getting the money and doing the promotion and things. And I also made the tracks and placed the art. But he built that framework that makes that game work. He made the drifting feel good. I think it's, we have this push and pull of like, me trying to push with my ideas and him trying to rein it in with the practical mechanics of it. Like, I know how I want it to feel, and he knows how to get it there, kind of thing. And so I would say that our feeling, our vibe is like, try something different if we can. Try to make it feel good so that different thing is acceptable and palatable to you. So, you know, we tried to make Gunsport feel as good as we could. There's more we can do with that. But, you know, the premise, we had some people tell us that the premise is what brought them into Gunsport and they liked it. We've had other people that are like, I look at this thing and I'm not interested at all. But then when I play it, I feel like, wow, this is really something and I want to do it. Someone asked me, like, so you made a puzzle tower defense game, and then you made like a mini esports like 2v2 volleyball thing, and then you got this driving game, and now you're trying to work on a tactics game. Like, why don't you stick with the genre? And it's like, there's just too much stuff that we want to do, too many cool things we want to make. Like, I've got this, I don't want to give it away because I don't want someone to steal it, because I think this is a really good idea, but I've got this plan for this tactics RPG where, you know, it's kind of a combination of Persona style S-Links and this other layer that I'm not going to specifically mention for unlocking those S-Links, which is different, very different from Persona. It's like, it's essentially, there's this persistent world, and through your interaction, you can influence what people show up and how things go. And through that, relationships evolve and story nodes open up. And I'm really super excited about doing it. It's a weird thing we're going to try. And
it sounds big. It sounds, in terms of scope, larger. Like the thing that kind of ties together your current games, and we didn't talk as much about Gunhouse as I would have liked. What a fun game that is.
Oh, thanks.
For people who want, like, a tactile puzzle game that makes them feel like crunch happen, like, you know, they got, you don't, Super Puzzle Fighter gives that to you. So many other puzzle games just kind of like, oh, the blocks disappeared. Gunhouse makes you feel like, blew up those blocks. Feels good. It's very satisfying game.
Thanks. I actually just played it. I played it all the way here on the plane. I was just like, you know what? I don't hate my game.
Yeah, but they were all a little, not quite single screen, but smaller in scope. Whereas this game you're talking about now, it sounds like it would be. Yeah,
this game is larger in conceptual scope than visual scope. It'll still be very single screeny, actually, but it's like something you can really poke at a lot, and stuff comes out of it. Like, have you played or heard of this game, Neo Pokekun, for the Neo Geo Pocket?
No, sounds cool.
It's a pretty cool game. So there's this guy called Neo Pokekun, and he lives in this house, and you can do things like poke him in the side or like feed him something, just like through inputs, like up, down, A, B, just buttons and stuff. And through bothering him and poking him and messing with this guy and kind of ruining his life, you unlock mini games and things happen. It's just this kind of a toy where things happen interestingly.
This was Neo Geo Pocket Color?
Yeah.
Did it ever come out here?
No. Oh, it was Japan only.
Yeah?
I get it. It's a good one. It's a real good one. And it's hard to unlock all the stuff. But it's that kind of like, here's a world, and if you keep poking at it, if you keep putting inputs, some output will come. You'll get something out of it. And that's the kind of, we're making an implicit, not explicit, story world. So it's not like, okay, like in Persona, which I love, it's not like, okay, I know that if I go to the mall right now, I'm going to be able to get some seeds, I'm going to be able to put that in my garden, and then maybe that's going to unlock something. In this case, it's more like, if I leave this here, maybe in a day, something will happen with it. I don't know. Could be something, could be nothing.
Huh.
And I want people to have this kind of feeling of discovery and like they moved the story forward through experimentation, not by being led there. That's what I'm trying. We'll see how that goes.
I'm very excited about the prospect and knowing that you're dropping games where you poke dudes as a reference point is, because I've always been a huge fan, and I'm a little sad that I don't think a ton of people share this because the genre has kind of died. But the Tamagotchi to Seaman, yeah, even freaking Nintendogs, like totally, having that I'm interacting with something else on the other side of the screen genre, for some reason realism and other aspects of video games becomes hugely popular, but only if it's copying this kind of passive medium of film. Like we're still copying film games to a degree. We're still copying film in games. Whereas a game that lets you like get to know a thing on the other side of the screen, there was that Kinect game that was supposed to come out with Molyneux, Milo.
Milo.
Never happened. That whole genre has just kind of ceased.
Well, don't worry about it. I got you.
Well, I couldn't be more excited about that. We're a little over time, but we started a little late, so hopefully we'll be okay. We do have a couple of questions.
Yeah.
One from Sasha. Sasha asks, what do you think about Konami going full mobile? Is it really bad or actually good? And Sasha, I don't know if that's actually what's happening. I look at that like every day. Nobody knows exactly what Konami's doing, but it certainly looks like they're going towards like pachinko. They're certainly leaning more towards that way. Yeah, gambling, mobile. I don't think they're totally giving up on consoles. I bet if Metal Gear Solid 5 makes them a ton of money, they'll keep making Metal Gear games for consoles, I hope, to some degree. But anyway, yeah, what do you think of the situation with Konami, Brandon?
Yeah, so I feel like Konami's kind of on my list of companies that are going the wrong direction right now. Because they bought Hudson at some point. And I love Hudson because my PC Engine biz, like Hudson, the PC Engine is made by Hudson. Like Hudson made that hardware. NEC released it, but Hudson made it. Like Hudson made the first HD game ever. It was High 10 Bomberman in 92. Yeah, on the first high-res screens that were made in Japan, Hudson made a game on the the Power FX board, and it was High 10 Bomberman. It was like 480p. It was the first ever HD game, basically. Like wow. Hudson has this cool, awesome legacy of amazing stuff, and it's just dead because of Konami, because they bought it and then they crushed it. Mm-hmm. They bought it and then they just threw it away, and it's frustrating to me. So, you know, them going full mobile, it's like, I don't know. I don't care, I guess. They don't care about this industry, I don't feel. They're a company that wants to make money. That's their main thing. They're a company. They want to make money. They see it's not really happening in games for them as much as they would like. So maybe gambling's been doing well. I've got a friend who works at the Konami in Las Vegas, where they do a lot of their gambling stuff for the U.S. side, the slot machines and stuff. So they're like, that's a big business for them. And it's better money than video games. I mean, it just is.
Mm. So, do you think people will, like, if they make a Contra pachinko game or a Silent Hill pachinko game, do you think that there's crossover in that audience? I personally don't feel it, but that's where some people are afraid it's going to go. Like, to play the new Contra, you've got to, like, you know, gamble, basically.
Yeah, well, I think when they do that kind of stuff, like, I think they have made a Silent Hill slot machine, I think. I don't know if I'm making that up.
But yeah, like, might not be. Yeah.
You know, just using their IP to make a slot machine is easy. It's not like they're trying to attract the audience. It's like, we have these assets, so we can just do it, and it's cheaper for us. It's not like they're trying to attract video game players. It's just easy.
They've got the stuff lying around.
They've got
Contra graphics. They've got the Contra music in the back door. Yeah,
it's still just going to be like 60-year-old grandmas towing oxygen machines that are playing it. Like, that's who they're trying to scam money out of. They don't care about the video game players, I don't feel.
It's the exact opposite of making a good video game, isn't it? Like, gambling, you pay money hoping something interesting will happen, and instead you're given, like, an empty experience.
I wouldn't say it's the opposite of good game design, because it's, like, psychologically extremely interesting. Because in terms of designing it for, like, engaging with a human mind and feeling, gambling does a fantastic job of it. I don't like gambling, but it really, it gets people to do that, like, oh, one more, this time, it's going to happen. It really gets people engaged just like right away, just like that. But to then retain them, there's a lot of design and psychology and mechanics that go into that. And so it actually is really objectively interesting to me, but on a personal level, I have no interest. I don't like it.
I should have said, in terms of giving something with substance with your game design is kind of the opposite of that.
Right, but it's like, what's substance? Like, because you'll get a real feeling out of gambling if you're the kind of person that is a gambler. Like, I play video games, so I get something when I play Valis and there's like a lady in armor running on top of a rooftop with the sunset behind. Like, as I've mentioned, that's the thing I like. Like, I get a feeling out of that. But someone who, you know, likes to win a little bit of money, like the people that bus up there from wherever, like, you get a whole group of people and they're like, yeah, I'm going to get some money. They really feel true feelings. They feel great when they win. They feel terrible when they lose. They're really, it's real substance for them. Like, they're feeling alive. So
larger day, the whole adventure. For them, the substance maybe comes at the end of the day when they think, like, because I made these decisions, this thing happened, and I ended up here, and I met this person when I did that.
I don't know. But Konami, are they going to keep making video games? I think maybe they'll keep doing, like, some big ones. Like, they'll probably do some Metal Gear. They might do another Silent Hill, like, who knows. I feel like for now, though, they're probably going to try to make money in mobile and just see where things shake out for them, if they keep going with video games at all. I mean, who knows?
Relinquish the Hudson intellectual properties.
Yeah. Or at least, I made a tweet. I was like, Konami, since you seem to be done with video games, just give me all the Hudson stuff. I promise you, I'm going to make video games with it. I'm going to use the Hudson properties to make video games.
That would be great. I wonder what happened to the creator of PC Genjin. Isn't that what it's called in Japan?
Yeah,
Bonk's Adventure. Yeah, I wonder whatever happened to him. He should do a Kickstarter.
It's hard to place who exactly started it, because if you watch the credits for the original Bonk's Adventure, the credits are like nothing. There are like six people credited. Like, most of it is credited to like Red Inc., which is, Red is a company that is more like an agency and like a liaison. Like, they'll bring the right people together, and then under their banner, they will help to make a thing, and then you just don't know who worked on it. So I don't think we really know who is the ultimate creator of Bonk.
Really?
Yeah.
And there was, Bonk 1, 2, and 3 on the TurboGrafx PC Engine. There was Super Bonk on the Super Nintendo. There's some other Bonk. Yeah, there was some arcade game. Is that what you're mentioning?
Yep. There's an arcade game. But also there was, I was going to talk about this earlier. There was a Wii game that was going to get made.
Oh, I actually played that for a second.
Yeah, Brink I played of it too.
Extinction. Yeah.
Yeah, it was not very good.
No.
But there are a couple notable things about it. And one is Rich Freeland, Disasterpiece, was making the music for it.
That's amazing. And now he did things with you.
Yeah, he did things with me.
He's working on the Retro City Rampage Underground, which now I'm panicked is going to get killed off because I guess Arc Systems works. As the Kunio Kun writes, and I don't know if that counts as a Retro City Rampage or not. I've already asked. Nobody will tell me. I'm freaking out.
Yeah, well, the thing is, Million, I guess, had licenses, and they would just license stuff out to anybody. Like, there was this time, so when Data, this is a different company, but when Data East dissolved, for example, mm-hmm. their rights went across three companies. Paon and two others, I don't remember exactly who. And so there was a time where I was like, all right, I want to make Windjammers. I want to make the new Windjammers.
Yeah.
And we're going to do it. And so we were talking to them. And also I was talking about Bad Dudes, making a Bad Dudes game, because I really wanted to make a beat-em-up. And the answer was, yeah, you can get the license for a certain amount of money. And then while I was talking to these guys about Bad Dudes, a Bad Dudes Kickstarter came up. And they were like, we got the official license and everything. And so I go back to these guys. I was like, what's the deal? And they're like, yeah, anyone can have the license as long as they pay us money.
That's not how licenses work.
It is how it works, but it's not how you keep a thing going and make it good. Like, if just anybody off the street can be like, yeah, I want to make this. And they're like, yeah, cool. Like, then you're in trouble. So the
people who were doing the Kickstarter, they didn't buy the exclusive license. They just, like, rented it, kind of, and anybody...
Exactly.
Oh.
And so I think in the case of this Kunio stuff, the license that these guys have is probably like that. It is a rented license for that one game. So, because there were a bunch, for a while, there were a bunch of like, yes, this is the real Kunio game, and we've got the real license, and we've got the original guy. And I remember there were like three at the same time making that exact claim.
All like 3DS games?
All correct.
Yeah.
They were all, because they all did have the license from somewhere, and they all did have one of the original people, and so that's when a license kind of dissipates into the ether, then it gets real confusing and weird.
Yeah, I guess so. I really want you to get not only the Karnov license.
Oh heck yeah!
The Trio the Punch.
Heck yeah!
I want you to make the new.
I will make a Trio the Punch. I'll make a Trio the Punch game right now.
Skippy 3, just Trio the Punch 2.
Yeah, I really like that I have the PS2 version that was put out by Hamster.
I had no idea that existed.
Yeah, Hamster Corporation. It's just the arcade game, but Hamster actually got sued because it turned out they were just using MAME. And they just built a back end thing that would make MAME work on PS2, and they were just like taking a game with MAME and printing it to disk and being like, here, give us $20.
Yeah. I totally want that disk. We have one more question. We've got a little more time, but I think it's been worth it. What a special episode this has been. Tibyz asks, how do you think studying film influences your view on games? Yes, you mentioned earlier. You could be making Jurassic Park 4 right now. That's the direction you could have gone. Instead, your brain got stuck in these video games.
Yeah, I like them. Like them video games. I hate making movies. I studied film at USC, got a film degree, and a bunch of my friends went to NYU, and they're all making movies. Like, I got friends... Robot and Frank's made by a friend of mine. That new tween movie that's about a lady, like something. I don't remember what it's called. Anyway, there's a friend of mine making that movie. And Cop Car is a movie that's coming out soon, also made by friends. Anyway, I hate making movies. I don't like it. But I majored in film criticism, not production. So I would say the major way that it influenced my view on games is I wound up viewing games from the eye of like trained criticism, which I wish more game journalists had. It's an actual critical theory background. And so like I never became a game reviewer or anything except in like the insert credit days, but I feel like that analysis of games came through in my interviews on Gama Sutra and Game Developer Magazine. And then when I started making games, like I couldn't help but see the systems of games. Like I can't see them perfectly like some people can. They can be like, I see what's like all the, I see all the math here. I don't see the math, but I see the experiential inputs and outputs. I see like how the camera angle in Silent Hill 1, when you're going through that first area, the first time you go into a gated area and there's blood, and the camera starts like starts down here, and then as you walk, it goes up around the corner, and then it comes back in front of you. And it's like, it's showing you, okay, you're not safe. Even the camera is going to make you feel ill at ease. Like we're showing you more, but we're also showing you less, because now you can see only what's behind you. You can't see what's in front of you at first. But now when we get up here above you, you can see that there's something horrifying going on, but you can't see in front of you yet. And then it comes down to the other side, and it's like always hiding the information you want while showing you information that's compelling. And like that kind of stuff has really influenced how I've thought about video games as a medium that can make you feel differently than something like film or books, because you're in control of this terrifying, interesting, happy, loving, whatever thing that's happening to you. When you're playing Tulip on PS2, Yoshiro Kimura is the director of this game. It's a game about, I'm sure you know, but it's about kissing people at the right moment. You're a mailman, and you gotta, there are unhappy people in this world, and you've gotta find the right moment when they're at their lowest point to kiss them, to make them happy, to make them feel better. And like it's this real kind of, I don't know, that's it, you're doing it. You're making people happy. They're not real people, but you feel like you're in this world because you're relating with them, and they have their own individual daily lives that they go about, and they're doing things. Like it feels like you're in a place, and it feels like you're pushing it forward. And you just don't get that anywhere else. And I feel like my critical background makes me see that. I can't help but see it. I have to see it. And I'm really happy to see it, because I like playing games that way. I like when I lose myself in a world, but I also like when I feel like the game, the people that made this game, they're talking to me. They're playing with me, because they're like, you know, in Ninja Gaiden on the Xbox. Like you start out in a valley, and there's walls on both sides, so you could practice your triangle jumping or whatever if you want. But and you're set on a path going forward. But the first thing that people that are pushing against the world are going to do is they're going to turn around and be like, "What's behind me?" And then when you look around and there's like, you know, there's like a waterfall and a power up and stuff. It's just like, we reward you for caring, for doing stuff. And it feels like, you know, okay, the people that made this game, they play games. They understand what we're doing here. They understand why we're here. They understand the interplay of systems and what someone who really plays games feels. They want to push against stuff. They want to know what's there. And when you push against something, when I was talking about the Bonk remake or whatever, when you push against something and then you're rewarded for it, or like in Halo, you get up to the top of this thing and there's like a Cro-Magnon family up there. You get up to the top of the mountain and it's really hard to get there, and then there's this family there. And it feels like a conversation with the developer. It's like, all right, we're all buddies here. We're all on the same page. We all know what's going on. We all care about this. Like, all of us deeply care about this medium, and that's the way that you feel when that happens. So, yeah, it made me want to make video games more of a discussion than a me didactically telling you something that's going to happen to you. That's why I'm excited about this tactics game. But I'm excited about all our games. I like video games. It's fun working on them. And man, the team that I've assembled, they all do all the real difficult hard work of like making network code work, generating these assets that are really fantastic. Like Odir is such sharp, high res pixel art. It really looks good. I mean, I shouldn't be telling you how great my game looks, but it really looks good, and all the people that are working together to make this happen, like I'm really just, I have ideas, I help make the company run, I write things, and I sometimes help implement some stuff, but like everybody is making this. I can't claim responsibility for anything as just by myself. And I'm really happy to have the people that I have working with me now.
I can't wait to see what you guys are going to do next and to see how people take to it. In that discussion, and we should wrap up, you define two key aspects of Necrosoft, which make you different from, to me, different from Vlambeer or Cactus and Denaton and whatnot. One, this you saying, I shouldn't tell you my game looks good. That's not something you hear. That is a uniquely, Necrosoft does have a humility to it, to me.
I worry about it. I worry if it's a bad idea. Is it a bad idea to be humble about it?
I think it's going to pay off in the space.
It worries me.
You know, look at Susan Boyle on America's Got Talent or Britain's Got Talent or whatever. You've got that Susan Boyle charm to you, Brandon.
Nice.
And on top of that, your absolute love of finding multiple points of contact within the experience of a game. Okay. So many other folks are, if they don't have an interest in or an ability for or practice with that critical eye, which is really looking for how many different points of contact are working right now, they can just get absorbed in something that's relatively repetitive and they're fine. But you're reached a point now where you love finding all those different points of contact and you want to instill those points of contact in your games. And now that I think about the games of yours that I've played, they all have that. You're not satisfied with like, well, it's just volleyball. It's like, well, it's got to be volleyball and the boat will tilt. And like, you know, you could kill the other guy. And like, you know, you're packing them in. And what a wonderful thing to do, to give people that many different ways to interact with you within one singular game. Fantastic.
Thank you. I hope that it works. I hope that people I hope people like it. I hope that it resonates with people. And man, in Gunsport, keep a lookout for the Hudson Bee. The Hudson Bee's in there.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Taking that risk. Taking that lawsuit risk.
It's fine. It's different enough. Different enough.
I'd love to see it. I'd love to see you make PC Engine 2.
Oh, man.
You just take all the Hudson NEC world and just run with it. Maybe someday. People can follow you on Twitter. You're Brandon.
Yeah, so I'm a Necrosofty. Necros. Necrosoft with a Y at the end. And also our company is at Necrosoft Games. So please follow that. And I also want to mention briefly that with Odir, we want feedback from people. We want to know what people like about this game and what they don't like about this game. So once the game is out and we have a website up for it, which is like Wednesday, we're going to have a forum where we're going to want people to join with us in discussing what this game is and also our future games and what they can be so that we can have like make it a dialogue instead of a one-way street.
Oh, cool.
Yes.
Yeah, I look forward to that. As for me, I'm at TronNauts on Twitter. You can watch this show later on youtube.com/supholmshow. You can listen to it on Libsyn or iTunes. You can also look forward to things I'm doing on destructoid.com. I wrote about Smash Brothers most of the day today. Ryu and Smash Brothers, kind of legit.
Right in there.
I'm impressed so far. He plays like Street Fighter, even though you're dealing with Smash Brothers physics and everyone else playing by Smash Brothers mechanics, but he's still playing Street Fighter style. Pretty neat. And this magazine will hopefully come out soon. It's got a guide for Smash Brothers 4 by the world champ of Smash Brothers 4 right now, a guy named Gonzalo Zero Barrios. We've got art by Corey Ray Lewis, who did the old Rival Schools comic for Udon.
Wow.
He did like all new comic book stuff for us. So much good stuff in there. So hopefully you'll like that magazine thing if you check it out. And I think that's everything for me. Thanks so much, everybody. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.